Hey there, folks. How's it going? Now, sometimes you just want some comfort food. And here in Britain, we do comfort food better than most. Today, we're going to look at cottage pie, an absolute British classic, but it can be kind of tricky to make. The mash can sink. The whole thing can be bland. It can be a little bit too sort of meh. I want to share with you an absolutely fantastic recipe that I developed, perfect for a weekend. Let's get into cottage pie. I've got four good-sized red potatoes today. These are Manitou, which is a rather floury variety. If you're in the US, I guess russet would be the go-to here, but I'm not really sure. Let me know down in the comments. Here's Mr. Spud back for another video, and he and I will just peel these potatoes as we normally do before chopping them into roughly 2.5 centimetre or 1-inch cubes. There's no need to be overly precious about the size for this. As long as the chunks are of similar mass and not too small, we'll be fine. As I chop these, I'll move them straight over into a pan of cold water to begin to soak out any excess starch. We'll give them a good rinse later to really get rid of that. As I mentioned in other videos where we do mash, we do want to get rid of that starch to avoid a gluey final product. But honestly, it's not as big of a concern here since we'll be baking this mash anyway. Potatoes done, I'll move on to onion. And for this, I just want one decent sized brown onion, which I'll quickly chop into a medium dice using my usual halves, strip the leather out a layer, slice it on the grain and then chop across it method. Again, no need to be overly precious, but try to avoid any really large chunks since we won't be cooking this for hours on end like we do for some dishes. Next up, carrots. I just have 5 regular sized orange carrots here. I'll peel these, top and tail them, and then just chop them into bite-sized chunks. I like a bit of bite in my carrots in the finished dish, so I'll chop them fairly chunky. If you want them quite soft, then do smaller chunks than I'm doing here. That way you won't have to change the cooking time. Once these are done, I'll move them over into a bowl, and then I'll go over to the sink and finish rinsing these potatoes. Under a cold tap, I'll just give them a real good rinse, keeping them moving, and change the water a few times until everything is looking nice and clear. That's the veg done, so let's move on to the meat. This is some good quality steak mince I got from my local butcher. It's much fresher than the stuff you can get in the supermarket. Just look at the colour and nice fine grind on this. Get to know your local butcher if you can. That said, there's nothing wrong with supermarket mince. Go with something nice and lean if you can. It will save you draining off all that fat. Something like 5% will work great. I'll get a good sized pan with a bit of high smoke point oil, nice and hot over a high heat. I'm using sunflower oil today. Use whatever you have available as long as it's neutral and has a high smoke point. So once that's good and hot, I'll drop in the mince and add a good grip of salt. Just regular cooking salt will do. Save the fancy stuff for later. After a couple of minutes, I'll go in with my implement of choice. This is a silicone spatula, you do you. And I'll start to break up the bigger chunks to give everything a chance to brown. So I'll just let this continue browning over that high heat, moving it around and breaking it up every once in a while for evenness. I want all the water to be gone and for the meat to be starting to take on some colour, so maybe 7 or 8 minutes. Once things are browning nicely and I hear that telltale snap, crackle, pop from the pan, I'll clear a space in the middle and go in with a good squirt of good quality tomato puree. That's maybe 40 grams. I'll let that sit there for a minute, poking and prodding with my spatula, just to ensure it's got good contact with the pan. And then just when I'm worried it's going to start burning, I'll roughly stir it into the beef. As soon as that's done, I'll follow it with a generous helping of Worcester sauce. Don't be shy, maybe 15 or 20 glugs. This is absolutely essential to our flavour story. I'll chase that with a good few glugs of Henderson's relish. If you're not familiar with this stuff, it's a spicy tomato relish from the north of England. If you're in the UK, you might be able to find it in your supermarket, but I've added UK and US Amazon links down in the description, just in case. A similar amount to the Worcester sauce goes in, and then I'll quickly get in and stir everything together before it burns. You'll notice this begins to caramelise almost immediately, and it lends a wonderful brown colour and a deep, rich aroma to our meat. The flavour here is already well on its way to immense. Just a minute or two of stirring to finish, and I'll pull that off onto a plate and let it hang out while we get the veg sorted. For that, I'll set the heat slightly lower, but still pretty high, and add another good squeeze of oil, which I'll follow with the carrots. Now, I'm not looking to cook these at this point, just to get a bit of colour on them, which will help bring out their sweetness and add flavour. I'll fry them pretty hard, moving them around to coat evenly in the oil and maximise contact with the pan, and just letting them sit and colour in between stirs. Once they start to develop a slight colour and are slightly aromatic, I'll turn down the heat to low, push the carrots to one side, and add in my onions. Now, I want these to soften and turn translucent without really browning, so I'll just make sure they're evenly distributed in the oil, and I'm going to add another good pinch of salt. This will both season the onions and help prevent them browning. And that's a great trick to have in your arsenal whenever you're cooking onions. I'll follow that with a few knobs of butter. This is maybe 30 or 40 grams total, and I'll just let that melt into the onions. The idea here is to help cool the pan a bit and bring an extra dimension of flavour into the finished dish. So on low heat, I'll make sure everything's nicely distributed, and then I'll pretty much leave it alone to gently cook until the onions are just softened and translucent, about 3 or 4 minutes. When things are looking good, I'll stir it all together to give the carrots a final minute or two in the butter to help bring those flavours together. And then I'll turn up the heat to medium-low and I'll bring that luscious meat mixture back into the party, making sure to get all the meat and juice off the plate and back into that pan. Before I stir everything together, I'll add a good pinch, maybe a teaspoon, of smoked paprika into the mix. This is totally optional, but it will add a very slight undercurrent of spice to the finished dish. You'd be hard-pressed to pick out the flavour in a taste test, but you'd definitely miss it if it wasn't there. To me, these little notes are what makes for a great flavour story. Optional, but recommended. I'll stir that through the mixture, and then I'll follow it with a little plain or all-purpose flour. This is half a tablespoon, about 7 grams. I'll just throw that in and stir it through as well. Now, once the flour's in, things will burn really easily, so I'll keep it moving and just let it cook for a minute or two just to take the raw edge off that flour. The point of this isn't so much to help thicken the sauce as to help hold the emulsion together in our finished sauce. After a couple of minutes of cooking and regular stirring, I'll go in with some beef stock. If you happen to have some homemade stock hanging around, then by all means use that and it will definitely be awesome. I don't have that today though, so I'm using pre-made stock from the supermarket. One of these packs holds 320 mils, which is perfect for this recipe, so I'll just stir this in, making sure to give the bottom a light scrape to deglaze it as I do. The whole pack goes in and I'll just give it a final stir to combine before turning the heat back down to almost as low as it can go. And then I'll let this hang out for about 10 minutes while we get the potatoes started. Nothing complicated here. I'll just set the potatoes in cold water over a high heat on a medium burner. Add a strong grip of salt. Again, the cooking salt's good. Don't bother with the fancy stuff. I give them a quick stir and leave them to come up to the boil. 5 minutes or so later, I'll quickly check on the meat and things are looking great. The stock is reduced by about half and it's looking thick and delicious. The carrots need more time and the flavours will benefit from it too. So I'll pop on a lid to keep things from drying out while everything comes together. After another 10 to 15 minutes, our potatoes are boiling nicely and I'll check on that meat. The carrots are really the thing I'm using to gauge the doneness here. Once they're almost but not quite at the level of bite I want in the finished dish, I'll call the whole thing done. So I'll just grab a fork and have myself a little carroty snack, which is also a good opportunity to check the seasoning is where I want it to be. These are absolutely perfect for me, so off goes the heat. If you want yours a little softer, then just throw that lid back on and let them go for another few minutes. It won't hurt anything. Check on them regularly though, and stir everything when you do so that you don't overshoot or let anything burn. We want to round things out with a bit of acid and a touch of sweetness. My secret weapon here is HP sauce. This is tangy, slightly sweet, and deliciously spicy. It will elevate our cottage pie to a whole new level. Now, a little does go a long way here. I'll add maybe a tablespoon, but feel free to go gently. Add, taste, and add more if you like. Like all things, it's easy to add and hard to take away. So if this is your first time, don't be afraid to take it slow. Of course, it's totally optional. The work we've already done will make this dish great if you don't have the HP. And from what I hear, you could sub in something like A1 steak sauce and be 90% of the way there. But I do recommend getting some HP if you can. You might broaden your horizons a bit. You'll likely find a ton of other uses for it, and it keeps basically forever. Once that's good and stirred in, I'll drop in some frozen peas. The quantity isn't massively important, so be guided by how much you like peas. For what it's worth, this is maybe 150 to 200 grams. Now, you can leave these out if you like, but they do have the added benefit of helping our sauce cool more quickly. So if you omit them, let the sauce cool for a couple of minutes longer before assembling the dish. I'll just stir those in to distribute them evenly, and then I'll throw the lid back on over this pan. The pie filling is done. Now we're just waiting on those potatoes. After 25 minutes of cooking, these should be almost there. I'll test them with a fork as usual, but I'm not looking for these to be as tender as I would normally want for mash. For cottage pie, we want a slightly drier, firmer mash that won't turn to mush, or worse, sink into the filling. So I'm looking for these to be tender and to break easily when poked with a fork, but to still give a little bit of resistance beforehand. These are absolutely perfect, so I'll take them off the heat and drain them into a colander immediately. If you plan to serve extra gravy with your pie, you monster, then you might want to save this water, but I've got no use for it, so down the sink it goes. I'll give these a quick shake and then put them to one side for 5 minutes or so to steam dry. While that happens, I'll grate up some mature cheddar for the mash. This is maybe 120 grams. Feel free to use more or less as you like, but we will be adding extra on top of the pie in a bit, so be careful if going big. I'll just run this through the large holes on my box grater and call it done. To bring the mash together, I'll just return the potatoes to the pan they cooked in. And I'm feeling a bit saucy today, so I'll add in a good teaspoon or two of creamed horseradish sauce. Whichever brand you have handy is good. This is another thing that won't be super forward in the finished dish, but it will add a lovely extra note to the flavour that you'd miss if it wasn't there. Highly recommend, but again, leave out if you wish. To that, I'll add 100 grams of butter and all of that cheese. I usually add warm milk to my mash, but for cottage pie, we don't want that. Remember, we need this mash to stand up to being cooked on top of the filling, so less is more when it comes to moisture content. I'll just go in with my potato masher and give this a good mash until everything's mashed and combined. I'm not going for my usual silky smooth consistency. I prefer a slightly more rustic mash with cottage pie, so I'll mash just until there are no noticeably big lumps. Once I'm happy with the consistency, I'll check the seasoning. This needs salt and a little bit of white pepper. I am using sea salt crystals here, which I'll crush slightly as I sprinkle them in. I like the little salty pops this gives the finished mash versus the homogeneous seasoning cooking salt would give me. But again, you do you. While we're checking seasoning, I'll check on the filling as well. This is good, nothing else needed, but adjust to your taste. You might want to add a bit of freshly ground black pepper. All that's really left for us to do now is assemble our pie. To do that, I'll grab an oven-proof dish that's the right size for our filling plus potato. What are you doing? Just... Oh, yeah, very professional. Really professional. So to do that, I'll grab an oven-proof dish that's the right size for our filling plus potatoes. This one is 27 by 22 centimetres, or about 10.5 by 8.5 inches, and I'll start by loading in the filling. I'll make sure that things look evenly distributed. In fact, I'll spend way too long doing that with only limited success. And then I'll start loading up the potato on top. You could go with piping this on if you wanted, assuming your mash is smooth enough. My mash is probably a little on the rustic side for it, and anyway, I don't want to have to deal with the cleanup. So I'll just go home style and load it using a fork. The move here is just to grab a good forkful of mash, load it onto the filling and lightly flatten it out. The filling is thick enough that it shouldn't sink, but if you press too hard, obviously you'll test that theory. So gentle is the key. Just keep doing that until you've got a good base layer of potato covering the whole pie, and then use the potato you have left to shore up any uneven parts. The aim is to end up with a nice, even layer of potato across the whole pie. Once that's taken care of, I'll use the fork to go around the edge and create a seal with the edge of the dish. Then just ensure that the middle has plenty of rough spots. These will crisp up in the oven and it gives us a nice contrasting texture. Finally, I'll grate on another 80 grams or so of that mature cheddar for a seriously cheesy finish. And I'll top it with a little more of those sea salt crystals to help everything brown nicely. I'll preheat my oven to 200 degrees C, 400 degrees F convection, or 220 C, 430 F conventional. And once it's hot, I'll put the pie dish on a baking tray for easy handling, and I'll slide it into the oven on the middle shelf. After 25 minutes, this is golden brown and bubbling slightly at the edges, and it smells amazing. I'll pull it out of the oven and I'll let it sit for 5 minutes or so before serving. It's essentially a lava at this point and it will just fall apart and burn your mouth if you try to serve it straight away. So give it 5 minutes, grab a serving spoon and dish up onto your favourite plates or shallow bowls and serve it as is. It's a complete meal, but you'll get no judgment from me if you want to serve some tender stem broccoli with it as well. However you serve this, folks, I hope you enjoy it. I really hope you give this recipe a try. Let me know down in the comments what you thought. Thanks for watching the video and keep on cooking.